Hello and welcome back to the Behind the Screen podcast. I am joined here once again by my good pal Connor. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. I just had a cup of coffee. I'm feeling fast. Not so furious.
Not so furious yet, but...
We'll see how this discussion goes.
Well, I can't be furious when I'm talking about the Fast and Furious franchise, because I think it's one of those franchises that gets a bad rap because people don't actually either understand what the movies are about or they kind of just brush them off as some dumb action piece. And I want to sit down here and talk today about why I think that this franchise of films... Everything it's doing so incredibly well.
Anytime I see a car jump a drawbridge, it gives me warm fuzzies inside. It's like I can smell the gasoline.
Every time you see a bridge raising, you get that little inclination in your head where you go,
I just want to hit the gas.
I want to hit the NOS button. So why do people like the Fast and the Furious franchise? Is it the high-octane car racing action that we've grown fondly over for the last 20 years? They've been making these movies for 20 years. The first one came out in 2001. Is it the cars, or is it the fact that we've been following the same characters, the same family for close to 20 years? Or is it a little bit of everything? I think that's what we're going to find out today. And we'll take it all the way back to The Fast and Furious, 2001.
Touchstone film of my childhood. That and The Matrix, I've probably seen 100 times. I saw it on home video like a million times.
Yeah.
We had it on VHS tape. I think the first Fast and Furious really informed a lot of my music choices as a kid.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. I remember like Pav City Anthem and like DMX Rough Riders Anthem. It was like the first real car movie that I watched. Brian's Toyota Supra. Mm-hmm. Is like, I still love that car. I'd still love to have a Toyota Supra now. And it's like, it's just ingrained in my childhood.
Well, you know what else is ingrained in your mind? 200 street racer cars all pull out and they're all driving in different directions to confuse people.
It seems like there's way too many people at those street races. Trying to keep a low profile, they're not doing a great job.
The director of the first movie, Rob Cohen, was super into actual street racing. And originally it was called Red Line because, you know, it's like the finish line of the race.
Yeah.
And the people in the first Fast...
I'm going to stop you there.
Go for it.
Red line is actually when your car hits the red line on the RPMs.
Oh, when it like maxes out
Yeah, so it's like actually like I'm fairly sure.
You're knowledged in the...
Car guys, don't come for me on this one, but I'm fairly sure it's when your RPMs max out.
We drive Priuses to let everyone know.
Yeah, the red line on my electric motor is
60
probably,
kilometers per hour.
Yeah, yeah.
So the first movie, Rob Cohen was super into the scene. Those were real illegal street racers. Like so much of the first Fast and Furious film had actual illegal street racers all over it. And I grew up with those first three movies, right? And the first three is actually a super strange kind of trilogy on its own.
Yeah.
The first one directed by Rob Cohen, fantastic film. But then Vin Diesel didn't want to come back for the second film, and neither did the director. So they went out and they filmed Triple X, which was, again, basically Fast and Furious 2.0, where Vin Diesel...
Triple X is what Fast and Furious has turned into now. Like, just, like, huge, like, 80s-style explosions with Vin Diesel jumping stuff on a dirt bike.
Mm-hmm. You know who directed the second movie since they didn't come back?
No.
John Singleton.
John Singleton?
Boys in the Hood.
Of course he did.
And the remake of Shaft. This guy made the second Fast... And that's the other...
The Shaft remake with...
Not the third Shaft remake, the one in the 2000s, not the one that came out last
year.
Yeah,
with... I had that on VHS too.
Yeah, with Samuel Jackson.
Sam Jackson.
It's very funny.
Yeah, I love Shaft.
And the thing about this is that you see so many different directors homing in on this project. You have Rob Cohen for the first one, you have John Singleton for the second one, and you have Justin Lin for the third one. And just looking at those first three movies, they're not really following any sort of plot because it kind of seems like Vin Diesel couldn't come back in. So they had to like rewrite some things. And then the third one is just a completely different movie. But then Vin Diesel's in the end of that one. So at that point, we were kind of like, what are we going to get from this franchise? Like, we really don't know what to expect. Characters are kind of coming in and out. And the Tokyo Drift really was the movie that after that, it kind of settled down again until... the revitalization of the franchise.
Tokyo Drift, for me, I thought they just kind of threw Vin Diesel at the end as like a red herring to be like, we could continue this franchise or we could just end it here. I don't know. It's that moment at the end of Tokyo Drift when he pulls up.
Mind blowing, dude. And
Han was like family, like that. That blew me away because I didn't think they were going to reconnect the universe. I thought they were just going to get farther and further away mm-hmm. from that universe. But
it would be some more standalone things.
They brought it back to the first film, which totally didn't expect.
And the incredible thing, too, is that it was one of the first movies that I remember being incredibly excited for the stinger of it. You know, the inception of the stinger was what? Ferris Bueller, go home, the movie's done. This one was kind of like the Marvel movies where... yeah, they're starting to introduce characters from previous films and you don't even know where they're going with it. But even they didn't know where they were going with it. Versus Marvel, they have a little bit of a plan. And they'll show Spider-Man in this movie. He'll show up in this movie. But back then, it wasn't as easy to go online and look up, oh, okay, Andrew Garfield signed on for 3 Spider-Man movies. Like, you can kind of tell who's going to survive the Civil Wars and whatnot. Back then, though, it was kind of just... people are getting killed in these movies. Obviously, they're coming back to life in later movies.
Yeah.
That stinger at the end of Tokyo Drift wouldn't have been anywhere near as impressive if we didn't care about these characters. Like, could you imagine if we just didn't care about Vin Diesel pulling up? But no, Vin Diesel pulling up blew our minds.
He made Fast and Furious the franchise. There would be no Fast and Furious franchise without Vin Diesel, and that became clear after the third movie. But even... his presence was so strong in the first film. He set the groundwork for being this like crazy badass action hero, which brought racing movies into the 21st century.
And after the third Tokyo Drift film, it exploded with the cast of these movies. I mean, at the beginning...
sprawling, absolutely sprawling.
I mean, obviously we had Dominic and Brian at the beginning, right? But just the amount of characters that they've created that are so memorable and funny... Letty, Mia, Roman, Tej, Hobbs, you know, Mr. Nobody, Ramsey, all these interesting, kooky characters. You can't see Kurt Russell without a bucket of Corona beers anywhere in these movies.
It almost seemed inevitable, too, that they were going to bring Jason Statham in at some point. Like, this is such in his wheelhouse, this franchise. I'm surprised he wasn't brought in sooner.
From the beginning, yeah.
Because he's like, this is totally like his born-to-play role.
And I think that what the fans of this franchise truly appreciate is the fact that they are willing to fudge up the universe a little bit if it means bringing characters back. In the third film, Tokyo Drift, Han dies, but in the trailer for Fast and Furious 9, we see Han is brought back to life somehow. They aren't worried or afraid of fudging up things a little bit. And again, with Deckard Shaw, with Jason Statham, we saw he killed Han. He drove the car into Han and killed Han. And we got Hobbs and Shaw, a buddy Rock and Jason Statham movie. Jason Statham was the bad guy in all of these movies, but they somehow turn it around with the fans accepting the fact that Jason Statham has kind of earned his due diligence in being part of the team now. And again, 20 years in the making, we followed all these characters for so long that, you know, we're just in for the ride at this point. Characters are switching sides. Characters have amnesia. They're shooting each other.
I mean, physics went out the window with, like, what, the second movie?
With the
like,
first movie.
Like, there's nothing there that's super realistic. And that's totally fine. And I think that's what people love about these movies, that there's a certain amount of cartooniness. And it is almost a throwback to, like, 80s maximalism in action movies, because we didn't have that for a while. And it's these big budgets and big explosions and big car chases, but it's not like something like Predator or something where it's fun for the whole family. Families can sit down and watch this. I watched this as a kid. I watched it with my parents. So it's like, it's I don't know.
Can you watch it with?
My parents.
No, what are they called? Family. Because everyone knows.
My family.
Family.
Family comes first in Fast and Furious. Try saying that 10 times fast.
So we've shown that like all these incredible characters are driving the fast cars. Like, I can't really think of a franchise where the things that they use are as important as the characters themselves. Maybe Harry Potter's wand and like broomstick are as important as like an Aston Martin car that someone's driving.
Someone tally up how many scenes the broomstick is in Harry Potter. It's not as many as how many times they're driving a car in Fast and Furious.
And that's the thing though. These cars are characters themselves in these movies. Like the tanks, like all the set pieces, like driving in and out of buildings.
And it baffles me, like these cars are such characters that they're still sitting around in garages somewhere. Like they put so much love and care into making these very specific cars specific to the characters. Like there's like the pink S2000 that's like all decked out, and it's a reflection of the character, and it's almost like an internal projection of their personality.
back home on Friday nights, we would go to parking lots and people would go park their cars there and pop the hoods. And you kind of just walk around and look at everyone's engines. And
you should see under the hood on my Prius.
They perfectly paired the comedic, humorous family elements of all these people bickering between these giant action set pieces. But here's the greatest part, though. The fact that they're in the cars driving them doesn't mean that the humor and the personalities end there. They shot that for real. They shot real cars out of an airplane onto parachutes for these movies.
When do you think they're bringing Tom Cruise in on this franchise? Because I know he wants to do his own car stunts.
Here's the thing. Did you see that video of Tom Cruise riding a train in, like, Switzerland and people just spotted him while they were driving next to him?
No.
Incredible. There it is. But I think that they're bringing in John Cena in for the next one. They know who people want to see in these movies.
They just, like, it's all, if you loved wrestling as a kid, if you loved Hot Wheels as a kid.
Hot Wheels. We were talking about this earlier. This franchise is Hot Wheels for movies.
It's Hot Wheels the movie, but if they tried to make a Hot Wheels movie, it would be terrible.
That's the craziest part. There's been so many movies, again, much like Triple X, you know, much like... I'm trying to think of, like, action movies within the last 20
Expendables.
Years. Expendables is a good example where, yeah, they've been kind of consistently churning out three of those movies.
Yeah.
But again, 9 movies, we're getting 2 more. We have a spinoff, and they're going to continue doing spinoffs.
And it's obviously the people that are making these movies care deeply about them. And it's, like you said before, it's the same kind of actors who like working together.
Yeah.
Maybe there's some beef between Vin Diesel.
Oh, there was a little bit
Vin
of beef.
Vin Diesel and The Rock, but...
They squashed the beef because they know...
Is beef really ever squashed?
The ground always wins, okay? People that like working together, but again, the crews and stuff. Like, I feel like the Fast and Furious franchise, they work so often with the same directors over and over again. People like Justin Lin did Tokyo Drift and then 4, 5, and 6. So the people that make these movies are... talking to the same directors again. And I'm sure they're bringing a lot of the same crew. And I'll bet you even the same stunt people they've been working for 20 years. Because when you find a stunt crew that you work with, it is crucial that you continue working with them because they just learn so much about you and vice versa that you can do crazier and crazier stunts.
Well, when you got a winning formula like this, why change it? People want to see these movies. They want to see stuff get crazier. And the filmmakers know that. And I know there's been talks about going all Moonraker and going
to
into
space. Space race. We got to beat a Russian Vin Diesel to space.
Well, they've got to put a car on a rocket at some point.
Well, Elon Musk beat them to the punch, right? Like, they better have a shot where they just pan over and you just see a little Tesla floating.
Who do you think would play Elon Musk in the Fast and Furious franchise?
Kurt Russell, obviously. I worked with a stunt guy that worked on some of the Triple X movies, the newest one.
Yeah.
Bubba. I tried to contact Bubba for this one because he was showing me the craziest videos on his phone of all these
stunts. We're trying to get
stunts.
Bubba on the line right now, but he's busy jumping downstairs.
Bubba doesn't exist online. Bubba's IMDb has like the one movie I worked with him on and nothing else. And I was like, I thought he was showing me like tons of different like stunts that he's done.
I feel like stuntmen are the most like libertarian anti-internet people there
possibly
are.
But again, it's like you gotta commend the incredible people. Like you watch Mad Max and you're like, oh, that was like an intense drive. But they do that for every single one of these movies.
Yeah, Mad Max was like an event in terms of the scope of it. But you're right, that's one movie. And they're doing these Fast and Furious movies. And they just keep upping the game every time.
I have a theory about what's going to happen when they go to space.
Yeah.
I think that it's going to be a race to space and a race to the center of the Earth for some reason. I think they're going to have to go into the Earth for some reason. I think they have to go out and in at the same time. The plot of these movies has always been a bit of a brush it off kind of thing. Because we talked about how they bring people in like Jason Statham and we kind of accept the fact that he's gone good. But again, I can't think of a franchise that spans such a big amount of time. People list things like Lord of the Rings, like Harry Potter. But 2001 and 2020, you watch that first movie when they're stealing those DVD players, it's incredible. It's such a little nostalgic trip to go back there, but you can also watch all the movies and see it slowly progress through time. The only downside is that fact that Tokyo Drift had to be squished up to like 2010, but then you have like Lil Bow Wow selling fake iPods to people.
Yeah, there's some stuff like that doesn't totally match up, and you know what? It doesn't matter.
You know, they use the real DK in Tokyo Drift that he's based off of.
Wait, what?
The real DK makes a cameo in Tokyo Drift. Japanese racing legend Kaishi Tsuchiya as a fisherman who's like making fun of Sean. But all the scenes in the film,
I remember that scene,
where Sean's driving, those are the real DK doing like the learning how to drive scenes.
That's amazing.
there's so many little things
even
like this.
His Sean's practice car in that movie, that Evo, is like amazing,
dude. Him smiling with a mouthful of blood at that girl made me laugh so hard as a kid. That guy had such personality. And that's the one thing I will say. The fact that they've been able to keep such a tight family with all of these movies. They went back to visit him and ask him to join. But he can't join because he's literally supposed to be in grade 12 in that movie.
Yeah.
And then Vin Diesel's talking to like a 40-year-old man being like, so, little kid, want to join my team?
They could bring him into the fold. They've already got androids, so maybe there's some time travel going on.
You mentioned androids. He is an android that Deckard Shaw shot and killed previously when he was working, you know, super secret stuff. And now Etienne.
Remind me who made this android? Some super shadow corporation?
The shadow corporation Etienne that Hobbs, they hint that he knows them somehow. So it's so we don't know much about The Rock's character because he showed up in like the fourth, fifth, and sixth movies. And we haven't had that much time to kind of explore him because, again,
he's Samoan.
He's Samoan. They go to Samoan, Hobbs and Shaw. He doesn't see Vin Diesel at all during the filming of Fate of the Furious.
The beef.
And the little gripe I have is that it's getting so technological that I'm not a big fan of saving the world plots. In Hobbs and Shaw, the plot is that there's a virus that's going to be released that's going to kill, you know, billions and billions of people.
But now, do you think that they've saved the world like a couple times? You think you can't back down from that? Because you got to keep raising the stakes.
So you're thinking that they're going to do the ending of Star Wars Episode 4, where they're all getting medals at the end of Fast and Furious, you know? Where it's like, you guys have saved not only Earth, but the universe itself.
I mean, you can't be like, okay, we saved the world a couple times. Like, we're going back to like
a little diamond heist, yeah.
Smuggling drugs across the border, you know?
I think they could do something. Because again, they're saying that we're going to get the ninth movie, two more movies after that, and then spin-off movies. I would love to see some spin-off movies about not saving the world and just classic street racing. Because I remember as a kid, one of the things that I was a bit confused about was that they would show so much footage inside the cars. Because when you're a kid, I just want to see the cars racing around. But they show the people in the cars. You got to show the actors.
Yo, I love those like shift inserts. The NOS button inserts.
The NOS button inserts are some of the best shots in the entire franchise. Because when they hit that button, I'll get goosebumps in the theater.
Yeah.
I forgot that the NOS existed. And when I went to go see Hobbs and Shaw, there's a part where he flicks it on. I gasped, man. I was like, the NOS! Huh, yeah!
The NOS
should, seems like such an old thing.
The NOS should be in every movie. 100%. Just like the Corona.
And it's hard to deny that the people that make Fast and Furious are taking huge creative risks with doing these goofy things. Because you got to think about, these films shouldn't work for some reason. Like, so many people think they shouldn't work. I mean, the examples we had before were like, you have a single Predator movie and the second one's not as good. You have Commando. But it seems like these movies are so great back to back to back that they are just incredible franchises. Like, there really is nothing.
It's such a juggernaut. Like, it's a freight train of a franchise. So it'll just keep, it's just going to keep going. And like, it's like James Bond. Like, if you have one movie that's like, oh, like maybe it didn't hit people in the right way, you're still going to have that next one and that next one. And I think people trust the filmmakers that are making these movies enough to know that there will be another good Fast and Furious.
And comparing it to something like the Marvel franchise, they'd have about 30 films. And with the Marvel franchise, it's more like you have to watch the whole thing and know a bunch of different subplots and a bunch of different things going on. The Fast and Furious franchise, it's so one after the other. Like, some pick up like right away, some pick up like a little bit here and there. But there's always something creative to look forward to. There's always some creative use of a car that you're not expecting. And that's the thing about the Fast and Furious franchise that makes it so unexpected. They're doing things like when they shoot out of one building into another and you're like, okay, oh, they're doing another building. Oh my God. They're shooting them out of airplanes. Like, I don't think that space, you can't drive in space. I don't know why people want them to go to space so bad, because once they're there, they're just kind of floating around. I mean, the joke
hey
is,
hey man,
what?
There's a pretty good moon buggy car chase in Ad Astra.
Yo, is there actually a moon buggy chase in Ad Astra?
I am 100% serious.
Is Brad Pitt trying to like chase down his son in a Prius or something?
Yeah, it's pretty wild.
Do you think that, with how expansive it's gotten, do you think that there's any way that they could bring in some sort of paranormal or outworldly influence? Like, do you think that they could do like an alien thing?
I think the way to go other than space and extraterrestrial is to go time travel.
I was thinking the exact same thing.
I think it would be so cool, like, if they were kind of, I don't know, you had a Tenet style thing where they were like racing an alternate timeline version of themselves.
Ghost race. Like when you're racing in the video game and you're racing yourself, exactly. How cool would it be if Vin Diesel was racing himself?
Exactly. Yeah.
See, that's the thing where you're thinking this out loud and it may sound stupid to hear, but they genuinely like putting things like this into the movies. Like they like experimenting and creating things that,
I mean, Back to the Future, you had the DeLorean. That was like a car time travel movie. That's an iconic car. I think they could totally do something like that with the Fast and Furious franchise and do it in a smart and fun way because people aren't expecting it.
A great idea could possibly be make it a smaller story where like some guy's tinkering with a new car design that sends them back in time as like a little spin-off. Like it doesn't have to be a villainous thing. Like I think that they could just exist in these worlds and come out with something really fun and creative.
Oh man, like if they had a plot where he was going to different times and racing different cars from different times.
Oh my god. And they said that a big inspiration for this movie was the car chase in Bullet.
Yeah.
And they even the Fast and Furious was a Roger Corman movie that they had to buy the rights from. So they're not.
Well, all this has roots like the 50s hot rod movies. Oh, yeah. They've been making car movies forever and car chases forever, and I think this franchise is just monopolizing on that. Yeah. Like there's no other car chases in Hollywood that are this wild.
It really kind of feels like these cars are their superhero costumes that they jump into. Where
it's like the Iron Man suit for these
characters. Suit for these people. They're when they're out of the cars, they feel very uncomfortable. They're like, things might blow up. I don't know what's going on.
That's when they're emotionally vulnerable and they have to have heart to hearts is when they're outside of the cars.
My favorite is when I'm watching these movies and they'll just put up like the title card of like a different country and I just lean back and go, how long did it take to ship all these cars over there? They're in Abu Dhabi. They're bringing like Aston Martins over there.
Just throw them on a AC-130, a DC-10. They're there in 12 hours.
I originally had an idea that, do you know what the plot for Ghostbusters 3 originally was?
No, lay it on me.
It was called Ghostbusters 3.
Still busting.
The Ghostbusters go to hell. I think that there could be something there. I really think that they could do something almost supernatural just as like a standalone adventure. Like I really do think that they could create something that was so, you know, completely different, but then people would also be okay.
Imagine how cool it would be if Vin Diesel had to race the devil.
Vin Diesel loves playing Dungeons and Dragons. Like that man is not like, he loves being a nerd. He loves all this stuff. So I do think that they're always trying to like, what else can we do to make people happy in the theaters? Because I've seen all these movies in the theaters since I've been going to the theaters. I've tried to see every single Rock movie. I try to see every single Fast and Furious movie because, again, Friday nights, packed theater, you're seeing these movies. They're
it's a thrill ride.
Dude, do you know how many people cried in the theater when they had Paul Walker's thing come up? I was in that theater. People gave a standing ovation.
Yeah.
Like, Paul Walker is one of those people that you kind of like, Paul Walker, what, is he like that famous? Was he really into that? People love this man.
He's such a part of people's lives after living with this franchise for so long.
20 years, man. 20 years. I don't even have friends that I've had for 20 years at this point versus watching some of these characters, which is why it's a big thing when some of these characters like Han Solo die and Han Solo.
Don't worry, Gorian. Vin Diesel will be your friend for always. I think, too, like, the franchise, because it is kind of becoming more and more out there, they haven't pigeonholed themselves. They can literally do whatever they want with this universe.
Yeah.
And people will be cool with it because they know they're still going to deliver badass car chases and the characters that we love.
Let me ask you this. Do you get the hate that it kind of gets, or do you think that these people are kind of misinterpreting or misunderstanding what they're watching, or not even like watching most of the time? So many people are like, you're going to go see the Fast and Furious in theaters? I'm like, yeah, it's one of the funnest things you can do.
It's hard to hate on a franchise that obviously people are getting so much out of.
Mm-hmm.
People love these movies and they definitely have their place. They're these like big maximalist Hollywood action movies, and you're seeing that kind of less and less. TV has big budgets too, but you're not seeing crazy knockdown, blowout car chases and action sequences like we're seeing in these movies. And I think there still needs to be a place for that in 2020.
Mm. And I'll just bring this up because I know we like these shows, but Justin Lin even directed episodes of Community and True Detective.
No way.
So these...
No way.
So you're looking at these people, they made Boys in the Hood and stuff. Like, these are great directors that I think understand the appeal of a fun family movie.
Roger Corman would be making Fast and Furious movies. If he could, like, they just have the visual effects tools to do what Roger Corman was doing 40 years ago. Is that right, 40 years?
Oh, I think more. It was 1960, so 60 years at this point. Another big reason why I think that this franchise has survived for so long, it's one of the only franchises that's existed since the aughts and been able to carry it into the modern day. Franchises like Halloween and Friday the 13th and Nightmare on Elm Street were doing like the 80s to like the 2000s. We had their last movies coming out 2001, 2002, but this franchise started off there, and it's very uncommon to have a franchise that the 2000s were such a radical nacho cheese extreme Doritos revolution that it's really hard to think that something survived from there. I mean, thinking back then, there was like a bunch of dirt bike movies. There was things like Eight-Legged Freaks that they just jam-packed full of motorbikes and stuff. We haven't seen motorbikes that often at all in these franchises. In Hobbs and Shaw, he has like a crazy motorcycle that is like the Batmobile that'll just return to him at any given moment. They've hacked into cars for these movies and like driven them through the city and had hundreds of cars remotely hacked into. The fact that this franchise came out in the year 2000 and they're stealing DVD players, the newest movies, they're like, yep, you can self-drive your car, all the features are in there, and we're going to mess with those features.
Yeah, the franchise is definitely adapted with the times, and it's like, you have to if you're making movies over, what, like 20 years. So it's got that staying power because it has been adaptive to what people want in an action movie.
I'm just holding out to see Vin Diesel riding a horse in one of these movies. I need to see a gallop chase. I need to see some sort of buggy chase, because that's the other thing. A lot of the times in movies like Jackie Chan action comedies, they'll have phenomenal sequences, but they're played up for humor. Like, they'll have these great little bits where people are getting hit and thrown around and whatnot. Versus in the Fast and Furious franchise, it's usually the stunts that are played for the laughs themselves. So the characters in those situations, I'd like to see a couple more, you know, goofy little things. Like, I love when like the parking enforcement person's looking around and their car just gets, I love little moments like that. And the Fast and Furious franchise is like filled with little one-liners and bits. And we'll just talk about the family now, because again, these movies are so multiculturally diverse. It's not just a bunch of white dudes in the movies. Like, it's a whole range of people from different backgrounds, from different genders coming together. Like, these aren't just streamlined. It's really refreshing to see different people on screen, but not constantly referring to it or like talking about it. It's just a diverse cast that's great together.
No, it's always been a diverse cast, like, because the original film set in Los Angeles, it's a very multicultural city, and they built that into the film, obviously.
Do you think that it's lame to talk about the family aspect? Because I do genuinely think that these are hangout movies half the time. It's just a group of 8 to 10 people hanging out, getting into little heists. Like, half of these movies are basically Ocean's 11 sequels, where they're like, oh, you thought we got the money over here. Oh,
they're always grilling.
Yeah. And that's what family's all about. Family's about, you know, roasting each other constantly, making jokes, making wisecracks.
Yeah, just have a half rack of ribs and a cold Corona. That's all I need.
It's a diverse cast, but one of my favorite things is that they don't focus on just one character for the entire movie. One of the things that's a bit grating about some of these other superhero action movies is that you kind of saddled up with one character, their problems the whole time. These films are fantastic because, like, sidekicks are always brought back and upgraded and, like, revitalized. They're always, no one's ever wasted. They're always brought back in for a little bit extra. And you're always going around different scenes, different characters. You get stuff from the villain's point of view. You get stuff from, like, the mechanics. You know, it's not just Vin Diesel all the time.
Yeah, I think the scripts are really serving their actors, and they know they have such strong people working on these movies, and they give all the characters their due diligence and all their little multifaceted stories, and it's this complex framework of characters that kind of fits together to make these movies so interesting, and kind of the relationships between these people. And I think when you have a franchise running this long, it's like TV. You have those parasocial relationships with these people, and you get to know them. And it's comforting to see these people on the screen again.
The love may seem kind of corny, but it's genuine. Like, the love is there for these characters. It's there for these people watching the movies. It's there for them making the movies. And I'd be happy with 20 more years of Fast and Furious movies. I think there's a billion different ways to take the film franchise. I'm all for the spinoffs. I'm all for the offshoots. I think there'll probably be like a Disney Plus, Apple Plus show at some point.
I think they're just going to be plugging me straight into the machine and I'm just going to be in the car.
The next Fast and Furious movie, they put you in a Ferrari and you drive the movie. That's what's going to happen.
If old Elon Musk is like, hey, I can put that chip in your head and you can be Vin Diesel. I'll say yes. I'll sign the forms.
So what we're saying that there's not any one specific part of the Fast and Furious franchise that we think people are coming back for. We think it's the cars, the characters, the plot. It's kind of weird that you have to explain such a complicated plot for what seems so dumb, but there is nothing better when I'm at a party telling someone the entire Fast and Furious timeline
for
20 minutes.
Yeah, man, you must be great at parties.
Oh, they asked me to do it. They'll be like, oh yeah, I think I've seen one or two. I'm like, okay, sit down, get comfortable.
Do you have 30 minutes to an hour?
I'll make it fast and I'll make it furious. Where can they find your family? Sounds weird. Thank you so much for doing the podcast with me. Where can they find you and your Prius?
They can find me and all my Prius content at @ConnorReeves on Instagram or @Connor_Reeves on Twitter.
You know what they really need in the Fast and Furious franchise? Those little motorcycle one-wheel things that people are riding around the cities these days? I'd love to see a chase scene on two of those.
Yo, a little hoverboard chase scene? You can put NOS in those, right?
Thank you so much for checking out the podcast. Leave a like and subscribe. And let us know who's your favorite Fast and Furious character. Mine's gotta be DK. Donkey Kong, right?
Mine's the guy from Crank.